And certainly, knowing that you're venting all that fuel out the wings, and also knowing that your brakes were white hot, that must have been...
Well, I bet we were taking lots of fuel out of the wings.
Yeah.
What we didn't actually appreciate was that I'll show you a picture of the leading, the front side to the forward wing spar that had five holes in it.
Yeah.
So you're flying along, 5 degrees of attitude, and all the fuel that's flushing the back. You land, attitude comes down, and now you start braking, fuel sloshes to the front. So you should talk to Michael, and he might tell you about what he saw when you stopped. And this would now, in hindsight, I can see why he says this. The fuel leak became really bad just when we stopped. So, yes, we're losing fuel. We knew that. We warned the fire engines that we're losing fuel, and that's why they put foam down as quickly as they could. We knew we had hot brakes because the landing distance that would be 1,800 metres of max landing weight, that cracked up for all seven reasons, performance reasons, but landing distance up to 3,900 metres. And so we knew we'd have hot brakes, but we were also told the wing brakes, because the velocity is skewed on the wing brakes, the actual wing brakes come down. It's a very smart system.
Yeah.
The Airbus has electric brakes. Boeing has manual brakes that are highly reliable. You push the pedal, you get brakes. Airbus has electric brakes. Actually came off the Concorde for best all the way through. But the electric brakes means you can put logic into them. So the logic was when there's no anti-skid, Airbus will reduce the pressure on the brakes electrically down to 1,000 psi, which is a third of the pressure. A third of the pressure means they won't skid and you won't destroy the tires. We have to put the last wheel down to put weight on the brakes, on the wheels. And remember, the spoilers are half broken, so they don't dump. You have to put more weight on brakes. There's many reasons why they were really sensitive putting the brakes on the start. But once we determined that we could put four bolts on, we did. The brakes on the body were at 3,000 psi maximum pressure. Body, the wheel gear was at 1,000 psi, a lot less braking force, so they're not going to get as hot.
Yeah.
Right? When you get the final report, you found it really interesting. Yes, we were concerned. We didn't have brake temp sensors on the wing gear, but it failed, so we couldn't see the wing temp. Again, the wing gear on the left-hand side was close to engine 2, but it failed with 7 fuel leaks.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, we were concerned. We couldn't see the temperature of the wing gear, but the brake gear is at 900 degrees going up. Again, the sensors are this far, a long way from the disc, so it takes 5 minutes for heat to go from the distance sensor. When we stopped, when you get to a thermal, 5 minutes after landing, you might see 400 degrees after 5 minutes. We see, when we stopped, 900 degrees. So clearly those brakes are beyond white hot. Now, is that a concern? Yeah, that's, and we were concerned. There was no question. You asked Dave, and he would say that was his probably second significant emotional event, because we had the old ignition temperature of kerosene is 220 degrees. Yes, it's not good. But again, you've got multiple problems, and now we're switching into a definitely survival mode. So we've warned Michael and the cabin crew to be ready to evacuate. They're actively looking at the window saying, if Richard calls evacuation, do I open my door? Do I use it to get the passengers out? And they're being prepped and they're ready to go. They stay on this alert for 2 hours, which is extraordinary. But we're ready to get out. We just need a reason. Now, okay, aircraft certified to evacuate 853 passengers in 90 seconds using half the exits. We had all the exits available, and we had 440 passengers. So we could get those passengers out mathematically in 30 seconds. When we do, we'd probably kill some, because elderly people, there's babies, there's wheelchairs,
it's very high.
And it's very high, it's very steep. This is not an entertainment slide, this is a survival slide.
I've gone down.
Have you?
Yes, I have.
Okay. It's down to 380.
No, I was in 1911, and it was in the training site, but it's real scary.
You have to hit the bottom of the slide, and the bottom slide bounces your body up into the air, so you come off the slide in a running position, you start running in the air, and you hit the ground, you keep going.
Right.
For a young person, that's fine. People have criticized us saying we should have evacuated. This is the decision that every pilot takes. Absolutely correct. Because they think, well, we just simply have to follow a natural rule that we must do this. We trade ships years ago, what do you do? And the farming says, from my experience, you just look at where they could be, where they are, which is the safest place, and how do they get there? And so that's a dynamic decision. It's not something that you can pre-plan. You have all the inputs, you have all the information. So at that time, yes, we had fuel leaking out, hot breaks that we could see on the boat. No fire. It's real, I'm dreading putting military people down slides. So we stop with this race. We get the farmers coming up and we get them to foam up the fuel, water over the brakes, and as the brake temperatures come down, clearly auto ignition problem starts to go away. There hasn't been a fire. If there was a fire, we had the evacuation checklist right on the panel and we would go for it, knowing that probably someone would die. Now again, the fire engines are there to put water around the slides to protect the passengers escaping. The fire engines are not there to protect the airplane. So I was confident that if we started to evacuate, the fire engines would protect the passengers escaping. And we only needed 30 seconds. Mm-hmm. So it could be quick.
Yeah.
But I didn't want to start that process. I thought the passengers are safe. They're sitting in an aircraft, it's quiet. All the crew controlling the inside. Passengers are calm, Mike is doing great PR, so we're doing PRs. We're actually telling the passengers our thought process, we're involved. We don't use the intercom. Any question about what's going on gets relayed over the intercom. In fact, even when the stairs come to the aircraft and there's a bit of confusion, I'm telling the cabin crew what to do with doors over the intercom, so passengers here. They're in the loop, they know what's going on, they're aligned with us. So it was very tense, but again, as the temperature came down, the auto ignition problem vanished. Then the system stabilised, and then it changed into a heat problem, whether we open doors and things like that.
Right.
And so that tension was there for probably 10 minutes, and then it started to ease off.
You talked about you had the AP available. Was that already running?
The first sign of you're probably going through the checklist, I think when we had some electrical issues, we just fired that AP up straight away. And we knew that we couldn't use the compressed air coming off the APU to power the air conditioning because there was, in fact, underneath the belly, there was a big duct that had been broken, been sliced. So there's no compressed air capability from the APU. But we could use the electrics, we thought. Because then when we get to landing, we touch down the engine, we finally say shut down the engines, and we do. And the APU is running, and we should have the APU has two generators, and the right-hand generator should connect to the airplane and power the systems. Well, the aircraft goes dead, goes black. Goes what they call emergency mode, which is now one battery, one two power batteries. So we lose 7 out of our 8 display screens. We lose 6 out of our 7 radios. And it's not apparently obvious we lose our radios. In fact, we lose a radio that we're talking to the farming room, which part of the challenge. So, but the APU generator didn't swap across. It's a really complicated logic. We lost an air data computer. We have 3 air data computers. We lost one of them. And the air data computer failure has a logic in the airbox that actually prohibits the generator connecting through. So the APU was useless to us, except the fact it was burning 400 kilograms of fuel an hour. So it was also being our dumping system. Between the fuel leak and the APU that is 400 kilos an hour, that was our dumping system.
Okay. The thing that you talked, you said that the Swiss cheese model is outdated and needs to be changed. Can you talk a little bit about
that? I was sitting down listening to the safety conference. There must be something to generate a bit of thought and interest. And I'm speaking to the cream of the safety organization in the world. And again, because of this book, I've been researching all avenues of human factors. And the Swiss cheese model came up. And other people responded, do I have a Swiss cheese model? Okay. Everyone loves it. Everyone uses it. It's everyone's answer to just like the area management. And but there's also a lot of discussion that it's outdated. And in fact, so I pinned down on the Swiss cheese model there, and I thought, that might be a bit too dramatic for the Flight Safety Foundation. So I thought, I think I said, 50 in the world, and perhaps there. Certainly in black spot case, the Swiss cheese model has no application. And for normal operations or small degradations in performance or capability, the Swiss cheese model is fine. Because the Swiss cheese model is a fairly flat and contained type where you start with hazards. And then you have the ways of Swiss cheese being you as a captain, me as a first officer, and the aircraft is another slice, and the system SOPs, all these different blockages that will stop the propagation of a hazard to causing a problem. Well, so this tiny failure, you'll end up with a few hazards coming through, and the Swiss cheese model cuts it off or it doesn't. 100% correct. What the Swiss cheese model is not designed for is an aircraft with 250,000 sensors and with 760 wires. All of these problems have knock-on effects. And the automation layer fails, or the system fails. And now we've got a flood of the ACAMs, a flood of the subsequent messages that come up. An aircraft degradation that can't even be detected. Now we take your Swiss cheese model has this in a irrigation pipe of constant size, and again, your Swiss cheese is a certain size, and you can cater for a certain number of hazards coming against you. Well, now, you take this pipe and you connect it to a reservoir of hazards, and flooding. Now you become flooded. So, the Swiss cheese model does not apply to where the actual piece of cheese is just overwhelmed and the water floods over the reservoir, and you now become incapable. You need a scalable system. If the Swiss cheese system needs a scale to increase hazards, if it's to survive in this box one model, and it was never designed for it.
Is there? There's a lot of discussion about training for complex or automated aircraft now, and I just wonder if you could imagine that any kind of training environment that you could have gone through to prepare you for what you experience.
Let me start by saying there was a comment near the start of the conference saying aircraft are getting easier to fly, and I think I took difference to that. I said no. The pilot's responsibilities are unchanged. We sign for the passengers' lives, we sign for the aircraft, and that will never change. We will always do that. What has changed is the aircraft we now are flying is more complicated. If we are to protect the passengers, we have to know the aircraft, like in the game we've made. He forced his first officer to know every part of the system before he can come onto the bridge. If you want to be responsible for your passengers, you have to know your aircraft down to the nuts and bolts. That's my thought, okay? So, the aircraft are more complicated, the task has got harder. Responsibility is the same, the job's harder. That's point one. So, I challenge the training systems produced by manufacturers, endorsed by KO, Radio Atlanta, Falcon. I challenge the systems where they say, trust the automatics, they'll look after you. Just do the simple failures. Because I think you need to be able to do pain, bridge, recovery of an aircraft that is severely degraded. Now, I understand that's going to take time and effort and money. Now, back this up for all those organisations to decide what level of safety and norms they want. What helped us on the strategy that day was the fact that we had extraordinary knowledge. I had been to Rolls Royce 2 weeks before, during the production line. I had briefings with all the engineers looking at surge margins on the compressors, okay? And I've done the engineer's course on the engine, I think it's part of the conversion, because I need to know. I work from the bottom up. For me to understand anything, I have to understand the basics. And I build an aircraft from the ground up in my mind on a conversion. And I talk to the Airbus test pilots. I knew the aircraft pretty well. And that's me, okay? But it certainly helped on the day. If you don't give pilots the skills to be able to understand the nuts and bolts, when the automation levels fail or the checklist is faulty, what tools do they have to recognize it and take the appropriate action? Mm-hmm. That's their job. So again, this is a decision for all the CFRs. So, what does it take to protect yourself from a black spot? Well, for the benefit of the interview, I think I described a black spot as being what, SAPs will cater for normal cases. My mom was catered for maybe up to 10 to the 9 or 6 in failures. From 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 9, then you have to do, there's multiple non-normals probably coming in. From 10 to the 9 to 10 to the 15, which is where we were, I think. I estimated 10 to the 15. They're running that procedure, right? We're in a new area. The number of failures that came flooding down from the system designed to tell us failures, and it got flooded when we got flooded. What we did to overcome those floodings of failures from 250,000 sensors is to revert it, look at what we had left, and we built ourselves a system of landing gear, brakes, hydraulics, electrics, kinetics, thrust, and thrust, okay? So we built ourselves a system and a full block. But to build that system, you've got to have some well level knowledge. So my point is, if you want to survive back splints, you've got to make a guy bulletproof so he's not gunshot. And he's prepared, and he's proactive and not reactive. And so that means knowledge, and it means they have the architecture in their mind of what the system's doing, how they're going to fly the aircraft, the really basic stuff about aviation, the really basic stuff, sufficient that they can build their own aeroplane, see what's left. By definition, we don't know what the next black swan is, so you can't say, well, let's do it all electric failure or something, because you can't. It won't be a black swan event. The guys have to have this base level of knowledge with the means of applying it with precision skills to build up. I think that's what the training is.
Well, I'm thinking in terms of a lot of the criticism that we've heard about training has been so much of it is rote. You always get your engine failure at V1. You always don't feel a certain routine. It's very rare, from what I understand, to have anything like your failure film in the mountain. You get multiple failures on short final with 30 mile crosswind and all that stuff, but you kind of expect it, don't you?
The training system is a relic of the past where they said the worst case failure was a V1, and in essence, engine failures never happened in V1. Let's make people capable of being an engine failure at V1, but not focus on it every time, because every single year we've an engine failure at V1. And it's not practical. Really what you should do is have an engine failure after takeoff, above safety height or below safety height. See how for 25 miles safety height and look at the varying cases there, which is actually very interesting. And it's certainly engine failures now, but they do that. But I think the route procedures of doing these failures based on some academic interest is something from the past, from the Second World War, and it doesn't apply.
How did the engine eventually get shut down?
Well, we tried to shut down the fuel control switch.
Number one wouldn't shut down. Okay.
So the fuel control switch,
right,
wouldn't work.
Right.
We look up. Any reason? No reason. Okay. Fire switch. Pull the fire switch, but now just cuts all the services,
right,
and nothing happens. Okay. We know is there any reason why we shouldn't? They said no. Okay, both fire bottles. It doesn't make sense. It's not moving them. Fire bottles are outside the core of the engine, but let's get them to go. But they didn't work either. They didn't discharge. So at that point, I knew there were dual wires. Each switch has two wires going through different paths to the valve, and the different valves with different wires. So I knew we had four wires cut to those two valves. And then I thought, well, the wiring loom must really be shot. But now the engine's running. Now, if that disturbs you, I will cheer you up, because we still had thrust control when we were doing it.
Yeah, okay. So you could pull back down a little bit.
So we had thrust control at our level, or full thrust. So my point is, the way we lost two paths to those vehicles, there was another path that was thrust that wasn't cut. That's pretty smart.
Oh, yeah.
So, but the engine wouldn't shut down. And then Harry Red got on to those Airbus and wanted to try and find out how to shut the engine down. We tried to transfer fuel out of the tanks, but the left wing was dead. We had a total power failure. They tried to transfer dumping system as well. We tried all kinds of things. They all failed. And the bottom line was we had 6 tons of fuel left in the wing, burning at 700 kilos an hour. We had 9 hours of engine number one running. What happened? I tried to remember the fire trucks are preserving the exits and the slides for the passengers.
Right.
So they were never going to give us two fire trucks that we needed to shut the engine down with water. They gave us front, the engine certified to take 2 tons of water a minute. There's no way you can put that into the fire engine. So it was never going to shut the engine down. They did try once, it didn't work. And although they tried many times, but it was never going to work. And so what eventually did, about 3.5 hours after we stopped, all the passengers and crew gone, the engineers taking over management of the aircraft, they injected foam into the engine, so it's the water in the fire truck with foam, and that foam must react in some form and it started the engine of oxygen perhaps, and the foam did shut the engine down. It destroyed it, but it shut it down.
I was going to say, Well, thank you very much for your time and your fascinating discussion. It really was.
I'm sorry, I'm not technical, but
no, that's good.